Thank you very much. Thank you very much for being here today. We are going to talk about artificial intelligence. And to do that, I'm going to share some slides. And Luke Julia. Here I am. I'm going actually to move my head, right here, so it would be easier for us to see the slides. And we are going to talk about AI, but we are going to explain that there is no such thing as artificial intelligence. And actually, there is no such thing as the artificial intelligence that people are talking about for the past 5-6 years, when they are talking about something that is fantastic, something that is coming straight out of Hollywood. And this is this artificial intelligence that does not exist. What I'm going to talk about today is to talk about the artificial intelligence that does exist, the one that we are using, that I'm using for the past 30 years, and that I'm trying to create, and that a lot of people are trying to create. So first of all, we should define or try to define what artificial intelligence is. And if you look at history, it really started back in 1956. 1956 is when a bunch of scientists got together and decided to create this new domain that they call artificial intelligence. I think they did a mistake calling that artificial intelligence, because you are going to see it during this presentation. It has nothing to do with intelligence. So, but anyway, so what did they do at the time? So they did succeed to, or they thought they did succeed to model a neuron with a mathematical equation. And they said, if we have a neuron, we have a neural network. If we have a neural network, we have a brain. If we have a brain, we have intelligence. And of course, we are going to see that it's not very true. And they were totally wrong, calling that that way. But anyway, so I'm going to try to explain what they were trying to do and what was the thinking behind that. The idea about this artificial intelligence was that we can replace some of the cognitive things that we are doing, ourselves with, some kind of equation, some kind of robots. When you think about it, it didn't start in 1956. It started way before that. And because I'm French, and because I think about French philosophers and mathematicians of the 18th century, I actually believe that it all started way before that. And it started in 1642, when Pascal invented the Pascaline. What is the Pascaline? This is basically the first calculator. Right, so it allowed to do only addition and subtraction, so it was fairly simple, but it was still complex addition and subtractions, because it was up to 5 digits. Right, so if I'm asking you right now, how much is 7,352 plus 1835, it's going to take a little bit of time before you tell me exactly what it is. The machine would have been right, right? So the Pascaline in 1642 would have been right all the time. So it was kind of intelligent, doing just the addition and the subtraction. So this is something that we can think, we can move into the domain of artificial intelligence if it's what is replacing our capability, to be smart or to do something that looks smart. But anyway, we need to come back to those guys in 1956. And not only I think that they gave the wrong word, for this domain, but also they tried to do something that is certainly the most difficult thing, the more difficult thing they could have done, which is trying to understand natural language. Natural language is very, very difficult, to treat for a machine. And frankly, what happened, pretty fast, they failed. So the machine wasn't able to understand at all, what the words were meaning. And so we enter what we call the very first winter of AI. And this is exactly what might happen today if we continue to say, something that is wrong, something that is not true about artificial intelligence. If we make it, too big. If we say that it can do things that it cannot do, we are going to deceive people, and they are going just, you know, to stop the funding, and it's going to disappear. This is exactly what happened, you know, in the 60s. Basically, AI disappeared because the promises that were given, you know, didn't realize. And then, you know, it was pretty much abandoned. And when you look at the history still, you know, in the 60s, it disappeared, but something came back, I would say, you know, around that time. And it's something that is called the expert systems, right? Expert systems is another kind of artificial intelligence. It's basically based on logic. Instead of being based on this, you know, neural network kind of thing that is a statistical piece of the mathematics, it's based on the logic, which is basically, you know, only rules that is going to say something like, if blah, 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 then do blah, blah, blah. Okay. So this part actually was very successful. And, you know, from the 70s until mid 90s, it was very well used, and it did give a lot of very interesting results. And one of the most famous results was in 1997, when Kasparov, you know, the world champion of chess, was beaten by the machine, the IBM machine, that was called Deep Blue, right? But when you think about it, there was really nothing very intelligent about it. It was really a set of rules, which is a game, you know, after all, you know, chess is a game, and a set of rules, and the machine had basically all the moves that are possible, you know, in chess. And there are about 10 of the power 49 possible moves, you know, at chess. So this is, you know, what the machine had in memory, basically. And I mean, Kasparov had no chance to win. So it was very popular, and it was very powerful. But again, when you think about it, it was, in this case, a game with rules and very, very applicable for expert systems. Then something else happened, you know, in the mid-90s, and the neural network, the statistical side of AI, came back, right? And it came back with something that now we call, you know, machine learning. And why did it come back in the mid-90s? Because something appeared in the mid-90s that was actually very, very important for all those techniques, those statistical techniques. This is the internet. Because the internet came with a lot of data, what we call big data, right? And those statistical methods, they do need a lot of data. So in the mid-90s, we saw machine learning coming. And then a little bit later, you know, in 2007, in the mid-2000 years, the deep learning, you know, came along, which is basically, you know, an extension of machine learning with even more data, you know. And the machine is going to be able to, with a lot of data, to do some recognition of some sort. And the very first thing that the scientists did at the time, because on the internet, there were a lot of images of cats that were basically, you know, branded cats. People were posting, you know, images of cats saying, oh, this is my kitty, this is my little cat, blah, blah, blah. So we had the opportunity to have a huge database of cats, and we were able to verify the techniques of machine learning and deep learning thanks to this huge amount of, you know, database. I mean, and we were able to create and to verify that deep learning and machine learning could work with a lot of data by doing a recognizer of cats, for instance, right? So with 100,000 images of cats, we were able to create machines that were recognizing cats at about, you know, 97%, which is very good. But, you know, it's at the end of the day, it's only 97%. Why do I say that? And why do I say that maybe it's not that impressive and it's not that intelligent? Is that I want to compare now with a human being, right? And if I compare with my two-year-old daughter, psychologists are going to tell us that a human being only needs about two instances of cats to recognize cats 100% of the time. And, you know, even if it's dark and, you know, it in any conditions, even if it's, you know, drawn by Picasso, which actually I don't know because I'm not sure that I can recognize the cat by Picasso. But anyway, so bottom line here, we are saying that the techniques that are being used by artificial intelligence, by machine learning and deep learning, have nothing to do with the techniques that our brain is using. And to illustrate that, I'm going to talk about another, you know, thing that happened this time in 2016. 2016, this time, this is the world champion of Go that is beaten by the machine, you know, that was called DeepMind. This time, you know, DeepMind is not using the same techniques that Deep Blue was using for chess, because Go is much more complicated than chess. I mean, if you ask mathematicians, they are going to tell you that they don't know exactly how many possible moves there are at Go. We are saying, you know, about 10 to the power 49 for chess. If you ask, you know, for Go, they are going to tell you between 10 of the power 200 and 10 of the power 600. So basically, we don't know, but it's a larger number that we cannot, you know, put all the moves in memory this time. So it was a statistical way to play Go, basically. We're not going to go over the algorithm, but we're going to look at the machine, DeepMind. When you look in the guts of the machine, DeepMind, you realize that it's a lot of computers. It's about 1,500 CPUs, you know, normal computers. It's about 200 to 300 GPUs. GPUs are special chips, you know, that are good for matricial calculation. So, you know, pretty powerful. And then it's about 30, 40 TPUs, which is yet another kind of chips that are made specifically for TensorFlow, which is a technique for deep learning. So anyway, so there are about 2,000 computers, let's say, you know, in this one computer. It's a mini data center, right? A mini data center just to play Go. And when you look now at the energy that is used by this machine, this is a huge amount of energy. So it means that when you compare with the brain of a human, you know, 2,000 computers against the brain of the human, it's basically 440 kilowatts against 20 watts. Okay, and the 20 watts, it's also use being able to not only play Go, but you know, they can talk, they can cook, they can do many, many other things with this brain, right? So one of the issues that we have as well is that not only we need a lot of data, but we need also a lot of power, and much more power than what the human being needs. Again, here, it's saying that the techniques that are being used by humans have nothing to do with the techniques that we are using in artificial intelligence. Another thing that we have to realize is because we are using a lot of data, there might be some bias in the data, right? So we need to be very, very careful when you choose the data. The issue is that when you choose the data, you introduce your own bias, right? So we need to be very careful about that, because of course you can make a lot of mistakes, and you can have some things that are going, some systems that are not going to work very well, or to even, you know, be pretty bad for the users. And one of the examples of that is what happened in 2016 as well, when Microsoft released a robot chatbot on Twitter that was called Tai. And this chatbot, basically, you know, Microsoft had to unplug it after 16 hours of operation. 16 hours of operation. They certainly, you know, spent months to build it, but they had to unplug it after 16 hours because it became the most racist and sexist bot in the history, you know, of the chatbots, which wasn't that long at the time. But anyway, so, but here we can ask, you know, what happened? Why did it happen like that? And we don't know exactly, because, you know, Microsoft didn't release exactly the problem, but we can imagine that it was the wrong choice of algorithms, maybe, and the wrong choice of data. I mean, if it's a wrong choice of algorithm, this is what we call bugs. I mean, you can always, you know, fix the bugs. You can always find them. But here, the bug could have been something like, you know, you always have an adaptability factor in a dialogue, in a bot. And so you want to adapt to the public to which you are going to talk to, right? So we can imagine that the adaptability factor was a little bit too you know, easy and to talk exactly like the people on Twitter. And, you know, you must know, you certainly know that on Twitter, after two or three interactions, people are insulting each other. So here, you know, if you want to control the conversation, you can decide to change the value of the slider. And then, you know, you are going to be able to have the robot doing what you want. But if the data was bad, I mean, the algorithm is not going to fix it, right? And it's very possible that the data was not the right one there. So, well, we were talking about finding the right data before, and we are talking about cats. It's pretty easy to find cats, annotated images of cats on the internet. It's much more complicated to find annotated conversation on the internet. So there is a database that exists since the 50s in the US, and this database is called Switchboard. And Switchboard is basically a transcription of many, many millions of conversations over the phone of normal people talking, people to fix their phone, to fix their washing machine or whatever. So a lot of data there for a long, long time. So you can imagine that people at Microsoft didn't need all this data. So they chose a subset of it. And you can very well imagine that they chose, a subset in the 50s, in the South States of the United States, right? So, of course, there, intrinsically, the data was racist. And maybe this is what, came back up when the robot, started to talk to the people on Twitter. So, again, you need to be very, very careful to choose the data and to be sure that you are going to do the right thing there. It's very complicated because, as I said earlier, you are going to add your own bias when you choose the data. Another thing that I want to touch upon very quick is we always say, we often say that AI is so complex that it's a black box. The reality is that it's not a black box. The reality is that we know, we being the scientists, the people who are creating the AIs, we know what the algorithms are, we know what the data are. As we said, we can have bugs in the algorithm, we can have bugs in the data, but we know what it is, and we can explain it. The reality is that it's very, very complicated to explain in my way, basically. So it means that you need to be a specialist to understand, how it is. And it's not the only domain in which it's the case. If you go in mathematics, you are going to have some very complex equations that only mathematicians are going to understand. And you are going to have, to draw something and to do something else in order to explain what it is for the masses, the normal people. And here it's the same thing. It's very complex to explain because the calculations are very, very fast, and the data is among us, as we said. So, but I believe that because people are working more and more on this black box story, and you need to be able to explain in order to have trust in those systems. So there is more and more systems that are based on AI themselves that are going to be as fast as the other AIs in order to explain the AIs that they are looking at. So I believe that little by little, we will see that. The point that I want to make as well there, I want to talk very quick about autonomous cars. I'm fed up about what I'm hearing about autonomous cars. We are hearing for the past five, six years, we're hearing that we are going to get autonomous cars anytime soon. At CES in Las Vegas, the big show in Las Vegas at CES 2018, people were saying we are going to have autonomous cars level 5 in 5 years. Level 5 is the highest level of autonomy, which is basically saying that the cars can do everything much better than us all the time in any circumstances, right? So they were saying that it would be 5 years in 2018. 2019 CES, they were saying 10 years. 2020, they were saying maybe 15 years. So now, actually, people that who are working in this domain, they are saying the truth, which is basically autonomous cars level 5 will never exist. Okay, it will never happen using the techniques, the mathematical techniques that we are talking about today. Don't get me wrong, we will go to level 4, and level 4 will be incredible. Level 4 will allow us to prevent a lot of the accidents that we have today. So we'll have most likely 90% of the accidents that are going to be prevented, and we are going to save a lot of lives, and it will be fantastic. But when you look at the domain today, we are maybe at level 2.5. So we are still very far from level 4, but we will never get to level 5. And for that, I'm going to give you one example that was actually given by the CEO of Waymo, because Waymo is the company, the Google company, who is most likely the most advanced in terms of autonomous driving, because they are doing that in the Silicon Valley for the past 10 years or so. And in May 2018, he decided to release all the videos of the 10 million miles that the cars, the Waymo cars, you know, drove at the time. And now there are actually 20 million miles that are available. But anyway, people like me, we went to look at the videos, and it didn't take a lot of time for me to find what I call a gem, you know, to show that it's going to be very complex. It's going to be actually impossible to reach level five, because there is always a case that we don't have in the data, that we don't have in the rules. And for that, I'm going to explain what it is. So basically, we see a car driving in Mountain View, a city here in the Silicon Valley. And the car, I mean, the street has nothing special, you know. And the car in the middle of nowhere, for no reason, stops. And then, you know, starts again for a few meters, and then stops again, starts again, stops again. Something three, four times like that. And we realize that the operator, there is always an operator in the car there, the operator takes back, you know, the wheel and drives away. Right, because I mean, the people behind him, they must have been a little bit sick to have this car, you know, stopping all the time. But now you say, I mean, why? What did it happen? You know, and you look at the video a little bit closely, and you see that there are two guys walking, you know, on the sidewalk. And when you look at one of the guys, when on his shoulder, he carries a stop sign. Okay, so when you drive and you see a guy on the side road, on the sidewalk, you know, having a stop sign on his shoulder, you don't stop. The car sees a stop sign on the side of the road, the car stops, right? So, of course, we can add now the rule that is going to say, if there is a guy walking with a stop sign on his shoulder, don't stop. But I mean, of course, this rule was never shown, you know, in the real data before. And it's something that is that is going to be very, very, very complex, if not impossible, to catch. Okay. So, bottom line, autonomous driving, level five, will never exist because there isn't actually intelligence, and there isn't empathy, and there isn't, you know, everything that we have ourselves in these artificial intelligences. Okay. I'm going to skip over, you know, Siri, but basically Siri was a very interesting project, in the sense that we thought that we could have a system that could be kind of could look intelligent, right? But we knew it wasn't. We knew it wasn't really working very well. So this is why we added what I call artificial stupidity in Siri. And this is because we added artificial stupidity that we made it look intelligent. So it might be counterintuitive, but this is exactly what happened, right? So that's why, you know, Siri was a little bit dumb, you know, by sometimes when it didn't understand, you know, it didn't understand what we were talking about. It was just, you know, telling jokes and saying, you know, nonsense. And it was what was interesting for people, and that brought people, and Siri, you know, become something that, you know, hundreds of millions of people used after that, just because it was fun, right? And it did start a new domain, you know, the domain of the assistants, which we are very proud of. But I mean, the reality is that it wasn't intelligent at all. When you think about AI in general, I mean, what I want to say that this AI doesn't exist as a whole, right? There are a lot of small AIs that do exist. And all those AIs, I mean, they are basically augmenting our intelligence, like you know, the calculator from Pascal. I mean, it was basically augmenting our intelligence. It was tools. It was a tool for us. So those AIs, they are only tools. They are only very specialized tools that are much better than us in a very specific area, but they don't have the vision, the holistic vision that we do have, and they don't have, you know, a lot of things that we cannot understand from our brain. Talking about that, I'm going to jump to the next slide, and I'm going to move myself away there. And we are going to talk about those intelligences. I'm going to talk about the human intelligence. I don't know exactly what it is, and frankly, nobody knows what is a human intelligence. We don't know. I mean, when you talk about the specialists, the brain specialists, they are going to tell you that they know between 20 and 40% of our brain, right? So we don't know much about it. But what we can say is that if we want to draw here our level of intelligence, you know, between 0 and 100, and on the domains of intelligence, you know, here on this abscess line there, we would say that, you know, we are pretty good. We are continuous. It means that whatever domain we are talking about. We are going to be able to have an opinion about it. We are going to be able to discuss about it. So I'm going to say that the human intelligence on this graph is a continuous line, right? But not only it's a continuous line, but I'm going to claim that it's an infinite line. So it means that whatever new thing that we are going to invent between us today, right now, we are going to be able to have an opinion right away. We are going to be able to, you know, understand what it is more or less and to discuss about it, right? So let's say our intelligence is continuous and infinite. And now let's look at the artificial intelligences that we were talking about. Let's look first, you know, at chess. So chess, basically, I mean, it's a genius, right? I mean, it has all the moves and it beats us all the time. And I would say that it's 100, right? So that makes sense. And now if you look at Go, Go is interesting because it's actually more than genius, because there are some moves, there are so many possible moves, there are some moves that were never played in the history of humanity. And this is why, you know, the world champion of Go, for instance, was beaten, you know, in 2016, because it did play a very surprising move that didn't make any sense, but that allowed the machine to win, right? So now let's look at driving. As I said, I mean, level 5, complex, I mean, everything that is going to be solved and so on will never exist. But level 4 will exist, and level 4 is going to be much better than we are. Because, you know, when we are driving, we are a little bit texting, you know, while driving. We are a little bit eating sometimes. Sometimes we are drinking a little bit. So anyway, it would be much, much better than us. And it is really something that we need to do. Okay. Now I'm going to go past this one. I'll come back to that. But basically what I'm saying is that whatever domain, we can build a tool that is going to be just better than us. This is what the tool is about. Right? And this is exactly what those AIs are. They are just tools. This is exactly like a hammer. They are tools that can do much better than we do. A hammer is going to be very, very good driving a nail, right? And it's going to be much better than our fists. But a hammer can also be used to do something bad, okay? So we have the handle. So it means that we have the control. And it's the same thing for the AIs. We have the control. We decide what to do with them, okay? I'm going to come back to this place here. And we think sometimes that when some domains are connex, you know, when they are very close to each other, we could learn from one domain to the other, right? So this is what we call transfer learning. And we can basically create models. And maybe, you know, by doing transfer learning from connex domain to connex domain, you can use continuity. And you don't have those discrete lines that I was talking about here. But unfortunately, when you look closely, you know, between two discrete lines, I mean, what you see infinite. You know, it means that there is always a case that is not transferable between one domain and the other. So it means that you end up, you know, with those artificial intelligences, you end up with a bunch of, you know, lines that are discrete. And when you want to cover the full infinity of our human intelligence, you would have to have an infinity of discrete lines, which we know that infinity, you know, is a little bit complicated. So anyway, those are things that we need to look at is the part that is infinite for us, you know. So the fact that the thing that didn't exist a few minutes ago, but that exists now, where are the artificial intelligences there? I mean, it's very clear. The artificial intelligences there are absolutely nowhere, because there will be nowhere until we decide to have to create them and to have them, you know, helping us and to create the tools that are going to be those artificial intelligences. With that, I'm going to stop here, and I thank you very much for your time, and hopefully, you know, we'll have some questions at one point. Thank you.
Intervenção de Luke Julia neste congresso da APDC.